let's first talk about, all of you are aware of, I don't even have to wait here. We know what do we mean by lifestyle disorders or lifestyle diseases. Diseases caused partly by the unhealthy behavior of us, unhealthy behavior in the way that is, you can say that lifestyle, your exposure to the light dark cycle, your routine which you are following, the unhealthy eating habits, etc. And partly, of course, we know what are the types of diseases which we associate with lifestyle disorders, mainly CVD, cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, stroke, cancer, COPD, depression, musculoskeletal diseases, etc. We know about it. Well, and then we also know that these lifestyle diseases which we talk about are having two components, controllable and uncontrollable factors. If we talk about the controllable factors, we know diet, which is determining your body weight, your daily level of physical activity, your level of sun exposure. We know the unhealthy life, uncontrollable factors, which are like age, race, gender, and heredity, which are usually associated with your lifestyle disorders. Well, here, one thing which is written here, and it's an old, age-old statement which we used to hear, we are what we eat. But then there's another word added to it. We are what and when we eat. So it matters. So I begin my topic with this particular slide, which is nothing but the 2017 Nobel Prize and this was on chronobiology for their work, long work which they had done in the field, which was actually mainly on the molecular mechanism controlling the circadian rhythm. This particular Nobel Prize in the field of physiology and medicine had actually opened up a new platform of understanding where people started thinking about it seriously. But it was not so new. The concept of chronobiology is not that new. If we go further, I'll just like to show this person's very respected person, Professor Halberg, who expired only in the year 2013, very recently. He was nominated several times for Nobel Prize. He was nominated several times for Nobel Prize, and he is also known as father of American chronobiology. And you can say the chronomedicine concept started the field which Munich, Astrop, Friedrich, and M.P. Chandrasekharan from our country, the father of chronobiology in India. He was also known as just a second. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. So, thank you. And sorry for this interruption. Well, what I mean by chronobiology is basically life is rhythmic. If you see around us, the whole world is rhythmic. The whole world, I mean by the constellation, sun, moon, their movement, their rotation, everything is so very rhythmic that we normally tend to synchronize with what is happening around us. So that's what we mean by the rhythmicity. And rhythmicity is a constant, ubiquitous behavior which is seen. So one of the constant characteristics of the life, and which can range from fraction of seconds to hour, daily, or even annual cycle. And I think everyone, most of you might be knowing about it, of course, that you have different types of rhythm, starting from circadian rhythm, which is a 24-hour, about 24-hour rhythmicity, to ultradian rhythm, which lasts for less than 24 hours, infradian rhythm, which is for more than 24 hours, and circannual rhythm, which is annual rhythm. And examples, as you know, many of the examples are there. Weekly, half a week, and all those rhythms are there. But what are these rhythms doing? Basically, why do we need this? All these rhythmic changes allow us to anticipate changes in and around us, and so that we adjust accordingly, or our body adjusts accordingly. How do we catch this? When we talk about the rhythmicity, one of the most important rhythmicity was a circadian rhythm, that is 24-hour rhythm. And this circadian rhythm is basically what we say, there are many day and it is a night, and accordingly the body functions are kind of regulated. How does the body get the information for that? First of all, you have the master clock, suprachiasmatic nucleus sitting in the hypothalamus and just above the optic chiasm, and this is one of the area which is known as master clock, actually regulating the circadian rhythm of the body. How does it get the information? It gets information about the light dark cycle through the retina, through the retino-hypothalamic tract, and from the retino-hypothalamic tract the information goes down to the thoracic segment, superior cervical ganglia, and from there the information comes back to the pineal gland. The pineal gland gets the information, the availability of the light, the intensity of the light. Now, this pineal gland, which is sitting in the roof of the third ventricle, is responsible for the release of a very important hormone that is known as melatonin, which is very much affected by the light dark intensity or the availability. Now, besides this, this particular information is also affecting our behavioral rhythm, that is activity, rest, when you are sleeping, what kind of food habit, when you are feeling hungry, all these are kind of having a rhythmic changes. So this is basically the way information is reaching. So light is entraining the suprachiasmatic nucleus and pineal cell. Well, I know most of you might be knowing about it, but for the sake of completeness, I am just touching upon this information. There are also extrapineal source of melatonin from retina, from GI, these areas, which are also responsible for the release of melatonin. Well, of almost all the variables of the body, if you see just one or two examples, you see, you have the highest blood pressure in the evening and the lowest blood pressure in the, if you see, they say highest blood pressure in the evening, it is coming. Your lowest body temperature is in the early morning, which coincides with a very high level of melatonin. So melatonin level, which reaches to its peak at around 2 o'clock, 1:30 to 2 o'clock, and within 1.5 hour or so, you'll find the body temperature is at the lowest in the night, midnight. Accordingly, similarly, you will find most of our variables, physiological variables, show such kind of circadian or diurnal pattern. Diurnal pattern, what I mean by 12 hour, that is in the whole day, you have a rhythm. Okay, so this is something which is, and it also decides on our it's also being determined accordingly. So, what we come to is that you have some of the factors which are sending the information to the brain. So, I talked about the light-dark cycle, but there are other factors also which are known as Zeitgebers, that is time givers. They are the time givers. So, they are social cues, the social cues about the timing and, our routine. You have your activity cycle, that is sleep and activity time. Your light and the meal timing. These are all Zeitgebers, and melatonin is known as the central Zeitgebers. That is, it is a central time giver to the body. Well, so we come to the point, what do we mean by chronobiology? Now, chronobiology is the study of mechanism underlying variability in the rhythms found in us, resonating with cycle around us. That is what we mean by chronobiology. Application of this information in order to understand the pattern of disease related to the disturbances of the circadian rhythm and why it is important, because all beings behave and react to stimuli in different ways and at different times. We don't react to the same stimuli similar to other person. So the reaction of our body also is different at different time of the day, which is the basis of chronomedicine. So, just to give you an example, this is a normal aging pattern. When we talk about a rhythm, you have a peak sometime, any variable you can take. So you have a peak maybe in the daytime and coming a trough or the lowest value coming in the evening or the night time. With aging, when the person is aging. So that with the aging, what we find this particular variable will not be same in an aged person. So what do we see? The amplitude is changing, it is decreasing, as well as the peak timing is changing. So the what we call as peak timing is the acrophase. So that is also changing. So we have rhythm which is actually changing with aging. In the shift worker, now we are coming to the situation which is actually the lifestyle factors which is affecting our rhythm. In the shift worker, what we find is there are behavioral changes. They have an exposure to an artificial light at a wrong time, or maybe not at the time when it is expected to be. So therefore, you have the behavioral changes in them. The meal timing is changed because of their shift work, and therefore there is a circadian misalignment of the body function. There is sleep disturbances, and therefore there are effect on the physiological processes in almost all. Also, misalignment is due to the environmental or behavioral cycle related to the endogenous circadian rhythm. So what we find is that you have a behavioral change because of misaligned environmental time factor with suprachiasmatic nucleus. So the timing is not matching anymore. And whenever that happens, what happens is the suprachiasmatic nucleus, which was the master clock, has its regulation on other functions of the body in terms of peripheral clocking. This is the the master clock, and the peripheral clocks are, that is, all different organs have their own rhythm, which is being regulated, or they are getting the cues from the master clock. So they have to run in synchrony to each other. Whenever there is a misalignment of the information, that goes as a situation which is a pathological situation, not a disease situation, right? So that's what is happening in this situation. You have the behavioral cycle which can cause such kind of misalignment in your central clock and the peripheral clock of the body. And these behavioral cycles are what we talk about, that is lifestyle related changes, you can say, the fasting or the feeding behavior, the timing of feed, or rest activity, that is the sleeping time and the activity time, or the other type of behavior which is actually exposing you to an artificial light. Therefore, these synchrony among the cells are coming. So, one example, a classic example I think everybody is aware of, that is jet lag. We all know that in jet lag, because whenever the person is traveling in the time zone, the person suffers from this misaligned circadian rhythmicity, which leads to a lot of insomnia, the feeding habit, the person is having all kind of nausea and all those other related changes with the jet lag. Interestingly, in the jet lag, few very simple treatments have been found to be very effective, which actually is the basis of chronomedicine. What are the methods? First is light exposure. Simple light exposure, maximize exposure in the morning for westward flight, and opposite in the eastward flight has been found to be very effective. A light exposure, that is, you are prolonging the light period when the person Second one was found to be, again, another very important factor which was found to be very effective is the use of melatonin. Melatonin and jet lag symptoms, the person who are taking the melatonin have been found to have very less symptoms of jet lag. But then melatonin timing would be important. His subjective night, when his subjective night should be there, he should be taking melatonin before that, maybe 2-3 hours before that, so that the body gets the stimuli that, yes, it is the time for high melatonin, and that simply means it is the night. So it induces sleep. Mind it, melatonin is not a sleep-producing substance. It is just a timing, it is sleep-inducing substance in the form that the body gets or brain gets the information that because melatonin is high, it must be the subjective night. Okay, so that's it.
Another one, which you must have been knowing about, is the seasonal affective disorder, which is mainly in the change in the season, in the field, in the situations of Arctic or Antarctic condition or the polar condition, where the light dark cycle is actually changing drastically with the change in the season, right? And these seasonal affective disorder, which is mainly seen in the lack of daylight in the winter, during winter time, suicidal rate, etc., increases tremendously in these people. And again, ultraviolet light exposure in the morning, that is for the winter people, and timed melatonin therapy, timed, mind it, in the... So, we come to the point, or we come to the term, which is known as chronopathology. What is chronopathology? It is mainly nothing but changes in an individual's biologic time structure preceding, coincident, or following the functional disorder or organic diseases. Or precisely, in the simple language, it simply would mean time-dependent manifestation of diseases. We are very well aware of it. The pain symptoms, the pain is... in the late morning in the early morning or in the late night. Asthma patient, the symptoms are much more in the night than in the day. So you have a rhythm. And these all rhythms are dependent on the body function. Your organ is responding accordingly. And therefore, according to that, the pathology is also showing its own rhythm. So it is mainly temporal gates of susceptibility. And this may be due to the aging, which I have already shown. It may be in the blind people. Disturbances, and very importantly, modern era and our lifestyle. This changed lifestyle is a serious threat to the circadian disruption. So, rhythmicity of disease manifestation. If we see one or two examples, I'll just try to like to give you one or two examples. What has been found is there's an interrelation of the master clock and the peripheral clock, which I was talking about. The peripheral clock is the body, all other organs who have their own rhythm being regulated by the master clock. The suprachiasmatic nucleus lesion leads to the clock disruption. And what has been found in these animals is excessive weight gain and insulin resistance. Not only that, there are evidences now, and very clear-cut evidences, latest informations, that you have very robust circadian rhythmicity pattern of almost all these hormones which are metabolic. The role of these hormones. Not only that, if you see enzymes and transport system of the metabolic pathways, glycogen, glucose, cholesterol, etc., and their receptor, all these also show a very typical rhythmic pattern. Now, what does it mean? It simply shows that at a particular time, more receptors are expressed, more enzymes are released, or more hormones are released, and at another time, it is not so. So, it automatically gives us a time of susceptibility to the disease, right? So, it's a theory which has been given. Interconnection between the disrupted sleep, and disrupted sleep would simply mean the amount of exposure to the light and the darkness is actually getting affected. The circadian rhythm and the metabolic dysfunction, they're all linked to each other. So whenever these three are misaligned, you have a pathological situation which is coming up. So, environmental perturbation of circadian timing impairs insulin sensitivity and promote obesity, which has been found. These people who suffer from lot of rhythm disturbances, lifestyle related disorder, you will find they are also suffering from metabolic disorder. Diabetes is most common in them, hypertension and obesity, all metabolic disorders. So I am restricting myself right now to the metabolic disorder, though it has been implicated in many other type of pathology also. This which were taken, they were given ad libitum food.
So they could take food at any time, and what we end up with is a morbidly obese mice. Whereas the same mice, when they were given time-restricted diet, simply, these animals became fitter mice, though remaining obese. Okay. Second part of the study was lean mice was taken, given ad libitum food, obviously expected obese mice. But the moment they were given time-restricted food, the outcome was lean and fit mice. So that means the timing of the food will determine the fitness of the animal. Okay, and
this is what we have found in the human studies also. So there is need for greater attention on the timing rather than quality only. Okay? More so because of modern lifestyle of the living and working in the temporarily disrupted environment. We are exposed to the artificial light. So we all are victim of social jet lag. We all are suffering from that, basically. I'll just try to, you know, bring one slide here. My own experience of about the same type of finding. What we found it in the human studies in Antarctica, which is known
as, you know, that a 24-hour light in the summer time for 6 months and 24-hour darkness in the winter. What we found is during the summer time, when we had the maximum disruption of almost all the rhythm which I recorded at that time, hormonal rhythm, body temperature, blood pressure, as well as heart rate, etc. And they showed the maximum disruption. That means it was not having
a normal 24-hour rhythm. Circadian rhythm was disrupted. And in those times, what we find is there was a significant increase in the parallel study was done
in the laboratory condition on the rat model, and what we found there also, similar to the human studies done in the Antarctica, we find here is that there was a significant increase in the body weight during the continuous light exposure of the animal as compared to when they were exposed to a continuous dark or, you know, less dark light. So therefore, And this time coincided with the melatonin, that is continuous light time when the animals are animal, that is what is expected. Melatonin is a dark hormone, darkness, hormone of darkness, right? And that is the time when the body weight increased tremendously at that time, significantly. So this was it. But now what has happened to us? The modern man, we all are actually victim of disturbed sleep habit or a short sleeper. Sorry for this particular video which is not coming. It was an animated picture, but it doesn't make a difference.
Well, so what we find is we all are kind of victim of this disturbed sleep condition. And what has been found? The chronic sleep curtailment leads to insulin condition, increased plasma glucose concentration, finally leading to the obesity and diabetes. So people suffering from disturbed sleep normally end up with obesity and diabetes, these metabolic conditions which is come. Now in this context, I would also like to mention here that we expect that we all are human beings and have the same habit, but we are not. There are many of us who are morning type, there are many of us who are evening type. So we are lark type or owl type or an intermediate type. Now, why? How does it make a difference to us? The intermediate
or owl type? For the simple reason, because of the demand of the modern time, the activities more so towards the evening with the exposure, availability of the artificial light. How does it affect? What has been found is that people with evening chronotype, that is owl type, tend to exhibit much higher potential to metabolic dysregulation as compared to the morning type. Okay, so there's a crucial and clear role of circadian clock in the regulation of metabolic processes through their
bidirectional interaction. Okay, there has been very interesting studies to show that significant association of short sleep with mortality outcome, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, cardiovascular diseases, arterial diseases,
and obesity. These studies have been done on the soldiers also, because they are also being exposed to a very hard lifestyle. A If we talk about the psychiatric upset, you know, disturbances, what we find is just a one simple, you know, diagram which I'm showing here is a dopamine receptor activity. If you see, this is the normal dopamine activity in the schizophrenic patient, in the psychiatric patient, schizophrenic patient, you see the level has been changing, increasing. And if they are sleep deprived, what we find is this leads to the psychosis. And at that time, if you see the normal pattern of dopamine activity has changed to this, the nighttime dopamine level is changing, which is reflected in their mood, in their mental setup. So, intervention of sleep quality
and circadian rhythm regularity contribute to reduce cardiovascular risk, which was a very latest study which has been done and has shown that if you can regularize the rhythm of the person, it might lead to reduction
in the symptoms of all these metabolic disorders. Well, ultimately what has happened? The modern lifestyle, the perfect Vitruvian man has changed to this. With love. And as well as all other factors. So, what we come to is management of disease should, because the pathology is showing a rhythm, so the management of disease should also be rhythmic. You will find at one particular time of the day, the drug might be much more effective than the other time, because that is the time the person's responses are at its heightened level. Okay, so it very much matters when you are giving the therapy to the person. So basically, that is the basis of chronomedicine and therefore chronotherapy. Time-specific treatment of pathological symptoms. Okay. It's been done by Dr. Halberg, which I was talking about. You know, very early in 1959, he had shown that survivability to the toxic dose of ethanol in mice was dependent on time of the day. What time was the drug was given, the survivability of the mice dependent on that. So that means the effectivity of a drug changes from one time to the other time. Okay. So this slide is just showing you different type of diseases which are linked with time. We all are aware of it. If you there. So you know that there are some diseases or pathologies which are much more conspicuous or clear at a particular time of the day, and the other one is at another time of the day. Right? So it shows a rhythm. It shows a pattern. Right?
Okay. So, just last example on cardiovascular chronotherapy, without going into details of any other factor, we know circadian rhythm of the blood pressure is, in the hypertensive patient, it is found that the rhythm pattern of the blood pressure is either inverted or disappears. At night time, the blood pressure is not coming down, it is remaining high.
Now, he was
given the medication in the morning, antihypertensive drug, and his blood pressure is rising in the night. Do you think it will be effective? It simply would not be that effective. You would need a larger dose, a second dose of the drug, and that too it will have its own side effect.
So that means what we need to know is his pattern of rhythm of blood pressure.
Okay? So we know, the myocardial infarction more frequent in a late night, early morning, non-dippers, which I was talking about, coincides also incidentally with less melatonin level in the night. And melatonin supplement have been found to be quite effective in these people, the non-dipper hypertensive. Chronotherapy seems to be quite effective. That means the timing of the antihypertensive drug would
that the same type of symptoms, one patient is responding, other one is not responding, because no information is available about his own pattern of blood pressure. Okay, so efficacy, besides that, you can see one more example. Efficacy of morning versus evening statin. What was found is that in hyperlipidemia case, the statin given in the evening time is much more effective than the morning with lesser side effect. Okay. So, these are some of the, just to show you one idea, that these are some of the devices which is used to record your rest activity pattern. You might be wondering, how can we do this?
because there are so many type of devices which can be attached to the body or can be worn on the wrist, and you can actually record a person's heart rate continuously, ambulatory blood pressure,
or his rest activity pattern, sleep timing, etc. So this is just to show you that. So what we come across finally,
indication of significant effect of non-invasive manipulation of the circadian pattern of activity and feeding time on body weight, metabolism and mood of the person. So what we need is circadian based
intervention, which are what? Light therapy, timed light therapy depending on his subjective day and night, and or physical activity timing, the timing of diet and social schedule, which is having a favorable effect on sleep-wake cycle and therefore very useful for the management of the patient with circadian rhythm-related disorders. So it has a potential to develop novel approach to new therapeutic strategy. And what is more important is chronotherapy. The main idea is and timed treatment, and that shows a better efficacy of the drug given as well as lesser side effect than those people who had to receive a higher dose to maintain or manage their pathology. So circadian friendly lifestyle and hygienic practice into the routine and medical outcomes are very much obvious here. Last slide, I'd just like to end with this. Normally, the current medical practice, if we see, is largely based on spot checks. The patient comes, you take his records, his values at that particular time, evidence-based medicine, and then the medicine is given. On the spot checks, have you ever, you know, most of the doctors would not even bother to take a second or the third or the fourth recording throughout the day to see what is his response. At that particular time, blood pressure might be low or might be high. Does it maintain the same pattern? So, when usually most of the modern medicine is based of evidences, whereas what we need is surveillance-based medicine. And surveillance-based medicine is you have to have a surveillance of the pattern of the symptom ultimately. And therefore, you'll find you have a word or term which has come into picture nowadays. Lot of studies are going on in this field, which is known as chronomics. You must have heard about the genomics. Same way, chronomics is nothing but the total pattern of the disease along with the all other external factors, the person's external factor, his internal variables are taken into account for days together, for years together in the population studies. And then you come to a genome-based library, you have a chronome-based library of the people in that particular location. And then the therapy can be planned much more effectively. So with that, I'll come to this slide. This was shown that the shape of things to come. But I think now the time has come that we have to talk on like this. That is, we have to go back to the early time and bring back the healthy habits which our ancestor had, because we have actually messed up everything ultimately. Thank you for your kind attention and patience. My few involvement in the present latest involvement in the field of chronobiology. Now, any other question? Any question from any one of you?
I would like to ask a question. Whether besides this sleep pattern, is there any other like auditory stimulus which yes. can change the circadian rhythm of various metabolic activity inside the body?
Of course. You see, when we talk about the jet givers, which I was talking about, the time cues, the social cues are very important. And social cues are what? In the night time, usually it is a silence. The less auditory stimuli that time, yes. right? If you have an exposure to a much noisy room in the night time also, your sleep is automatically disturbed. And that is bound to affect your normal sleep pattern as well as your other, body behavior. So it has to... basically. So it is one of the social cues, of course.
Thank you.
Yes, any question from anybody who are right now with us? I would be very happy. I am open to all criticism, any kind of question or suggestion. Right now. Okay. If there are none, then I would like to thank. There's a question.
I have heard you mentioned nice. Presented. One more query is, what about congenitally blind people? I mean, those who are born blind, since these are more related to light and dark cycle, are they throughout their lives prone to more diseases? The pattern you have seen, congenitally blind.
Yeah, it's a very important, very pertinent question actually, and I would really like to answer this question, because
blind people, as I said in one statement, they do suffer from some circadian disturbances. But then not all blind people are kind of misaligned to the social cues or to a normal lifestyle. Usually what happens, what we believe is that a retina is sensing the light-dark cycle and sending the information to the pineal gland. But it's not the only rod and cone cells which are responsible for that. There are melanopsin in retina which are sensitive to light, and even but then again, one more fact which I did mention is, with aging, the people have disturbances in the rhythm. What is found is, in with aging, we find cataract, retinal diseases, retinodegenerative type of diseases. In those cases, the light information is not reaching properly. That is mimicking a situation where the light dark is not reaching. So, what I want to say is, not all blind people suffer from misaligned rhythm, because they still do get some information about the light dark cycle. But yes, then how do they synchronize themselves? It is mainly through the social cues. They are given because they are put in the society, and they try to relate or they try to adjust their timing, their behavior with the other sighted people, you can say. And therefore, they do have their own rhythm. But yes, blind people, there are lot of circadian rhythm related disturbances leading to many of the pathology in them. It is very commonly seen in them also. So there are two aspects of it. Yes, yeah, sure.
Ma'am, that was a very informative presentation, so I'd like to thank you for that. I have a small doubt. You mentioned about seasonal affective disorders. So in seasonal affective disorders throughout the place, for example, like higher up in Canada or near the Arctic Circle, like you mentioned, everybody will be exposed to the same kind of rhythmicity.
Of course.
So what about the pathology in those kind of places?
Yes. Whenever we generalize facts, you see, we say in polar areas we have this problem. In those
Arctic area, you have more of seasonal affective disorder in Japan and those areas. But not everybody suffers from that. So it is the susceptibility of the person. As I said, not all blind people are having these circadian rhythm disturbances. It's the susceptibility of the person.
So there are few people who are very susceptible to the changes in these light dark. Actually, light exposure, a very easy way of doing it and very non-invasive method is, expose yourself for a longer light period in the night time, for those polar people who are being exposed to a longer night. So it is very easy, and there you will find many of the people do change their routine accordingly. In fact, it's very interestingly what has been found in the polar area, in these areas, the women stop menstruating in these periods. They stop their cyclicity for about 2-3 months, and then the cyclicity ensues again. So this is kind of changes which is happening in them. proportion of people suffering from seasonal affective disorder is much more there as compared to the tropical countries. That is. Yes. Any question from any place? Yeah. Yeah.
Hello. Ma'am, my question is directly related to this sleep criteria for every individual. Like you have said that the amount of sleep an individual is taking is directly related to their work performance. So can we directly say that the amount of sleep that an individual is taking is directly proportional to their work level performance?
It is in a way true for the reason because this generation, they are actually victim of very short sleep duration. Now it is recommended 8 hours minimum sleep is required. The youngsters our this era, they are hardly having such kind of sleep pattern. And it has been proved beyond doubt now that there are a lot of studies, recent studies, which has shown that those people who have sleep curtailment for long period of time, the reflection is not only in terms of they having symptoms of diabetes or hypertension, their work behavior, their mood changes are much more, you know, conspicuous as compared to the others. It is very much there. So that means the mental setup of a person would be determined by how much sleep and activity period is there. But then the sleep is the time when you have the regenerative functions of the body being, you know, going on. And we are actually curtailing that role to play. So that's what. So whenever you have sleep curtailment, you are might be curtailing the REM sleep, every 90-minute sleep, you know, cycle which we talk about. You see, even in the sleep, we find a cyclicity. Every 90 minutes, we find the REM sleep and then again the non-REM sleep. So the rhythmicity is there also. We are disturbing whenever we have a disturbed sleep pattern. And the information accordingly will be conveyed to the body function.
So it varies in every individual.
Has to be.
Thank you.
Any question from, yeah, sure. Good afternoon.
Yeah, my question is, from the discussion, can we conclude that there is more weight gain in the summer season?
Not really. Because if you would have heard what I said is that summer heated, you know, the high temperature time. It's a time when the, you know, you have 24 hours day, right? And what we found is that, you know, 24-hour day or prolonged day leads to lot of disruption of the body circadian rhythm. So whenever that happens, that leads to a situation which is a metabolic dysfunction state and leading thereby to maybe obesity, hypertension, etc., all those metabolic disorder. It has got nothing to do with the temperature parameter which we are talking about. So in the summertime, we gain more weight. It is not true at all. What is more important here is the duration of the light exposure, which will ultimately affect your master clock and the other clock behavior. I hope I have answered you satisfactorily. Any other clarification?
Hello, ma'am, may I ask you a question? I'm from Andhra Medical College. Hello? Ma'am, am I audible to you?
Yeah,
actually,
hello? You are audible. Problem.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, at the end of your lecture, you showed us this picture that as a result of all this, what is ultimately happening is like we are losing our body shapes and we are becoming creatures we were not meant to be. So, ma'am, I really want to ask you that there are countries where we have a continuous of 3 and 4 months of nights and 2 and 3 months of sun. And these are northern European countries, Nordic countries. So I want to ask you that in India, we are having a 12-hour day and 12-hour night. And they are not having that kind of thing. So given seeing the whole situation from the point of view of this cues thing affecting people's lifestyle, so are these individuals in any way more unhealthy than us, like we, the Indian people? Because as far as my knowledge about these people goes, they are the people and the countries which are mostly highest in the list of prosperity index from United Nations continuously almost every year. So yes, this doesn't kind of correlate factually. Yes. So I want clearance on that. Yeah.
Very good question, I must say. And I must answer this because this is a very pertinent question for the topic which I have spoken on.
My topic was on the lifestyle related disorder. And when we say lifestyle is there, that is only one of the time giver for our master clock and for all other clock of the body. But the other factors which are playing a very important role, the habit behavior which we are following. And if we see in Indian population, yes, it's becoming like a capital country of diabetes very soon, which shows that we have a very, very abnormal lifestyle, you can see. An abnormal lifestyle, I would mean that, the food habit, the junk food habit, and as I said in the beginning, that what we are is what we eat. Not only that, when we eat and how we eat is one of the factors which determines. Then the stress level, which is another factor which affects our whole of the body functioning, ultimately the rhythm pattern also, as I showed the mood swings in the rhythm alteration. And it's very obvious the kind of stress which our population is having, the young generation, the kind of competition which we are having, these are all bound to have effect on our body function, which might be one of the most important reason. As you said, in the the areas where the Arctic area or Antarctic area or the South and the North Polar area, the light duration is much more longer in the summer time. Winter time, you have continuous night exposure. Does it mean they suffer more than us? No. For the reason, because they have adapted also accordingly. Most of the people have adapted accordingly. Our problem is, we are adapting to a wrong behavior. Artificial light for a very prolonged time in the night, which is actually affecting our rhythm pattern. What we need to change mainly is our lifestyle. The lifestyle would mean light dark, of course, the food habit, the stress level, how we manage our stress level, all these will determine finally. And I would like to just add one more sentence here, because you have raised this, that you see, when we say that we are, I showed you the lark type and the owl type, that is, we are morning type and the evening type. But evolutionary scale, if we say, in the evolutionary scale, you will find we were made to be and we are meant to be lark type only. Molecular level, if you see, molecular level, our whole molecule genes, which are clock genes, which have been worked out, have a lark type of rhythm. We, because of our change, lifestyle, have made ourselves either an intermediate or an evening type people. So that is not something akin to what evolutionary scale had given us. And that is the reason why you have so much of disruption and so many type of manifestation which we suffer from these days.